We're going to go ahead and get started. Hi, everyone. We're back, and it's really exciting to see you guys all here. As people start filtering in, just don't get too distracted. Guys, we're so happy you're here. First of all, to all the fathers out there, we want to say Happy Father's Day. You guys are a true blessing to our church community, as well as to your families. But guys, again, I don't want to say, I'm so excited to be here. I'm so excited to back up with you guys, to see your faces every Sunday now. Brings me a lot of joy. And so something I want to speak to this morning before we get started, if you've been watching the videos, we've spent a little bit of time of reflection on current events and spending time in prayer. I'd like to bring us into that this morning before we start our worship. I'm going to read here in James chapter 1, starting verse 2. It says, "Count it all joy, my brothers, when you meet trials of various kinds, for you know that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness. And let steadfastness have its full effect, being made perfect and complete, lacking nothing." In this time, especially in the last few months, we've all gone through a lot. We've gone through quarantine, we've gone through social distancing, we've gone through missing time with family and friends. And then now entering into a time where our nation is seemingly more at unrest. And in that time, it can be really hard to find joy. It can be really hard to reflect on the things that God has done for us and to treasure those things and find the light. But as we see here in James, the call for our lives is not simply to cower and to be afraid, but instead to be joyful in all things. Later on in chapter 1, "Do not be deceived, my beloved brothers. Every good gift and every perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow to change." We have this sure, steadfast hope that our God is in control, that He is here, that He loves us, that He cares for us, and that He has provided so much for us. And so this morning, I want to pray. You can pray with me, you can pray to yourselves. Pray that God would work in a way for us to reflect and see the good that He's done in this moment. See the goodness in Him and the joy that He brings in all circumstances. So would you pray with me? Lord, we come before you this morning, God, in kind of a mixed state. Lord, we are so joyful to be here together, meeting as a congregation, singing praises to your name with our fellow brothers and sisters, God. And there's such joy in that. But there's also pain with the state of our world right now, of our country. And it weighs heavy on us, Lord. A lot of uncertainty of how to act, how to see good right now. But Lord, there's a lot of good that's happening. You are working amazing ways, guiding us, providing for us. And I pray that we rest in that this morning, and that we sing with joy and rejoicing in your name for all the good that you have done. For Lord, while it seems like now is a dark time, Lord, we know that the light is coming, the dawn is here, it is coming, Lord. We know that the work is finished. We know that Christ has done it all, and that we will be brought to you soon. And that brings us great joy. Alright, let's stand. Let's sing some worship this morning. Thank you. Lord, and now we can rest in the reality that you have stamped your approval on us, God, that you have paid the debt for our sins, Lord, that we might rejoice, that we may have joy even in sorrow and struggle and suffering, God. We might bring that joy as a light to the world, to the nations. Lord, give us that desire. Help us, just fill us with that joy that it might pour out of us, and we can show off your glory through your name. We love you, Lord. Thank you for loving us far more. Through your prayer. Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Wow. Okay. I know it's a little bit different, right? We're not sitting on our couches. Or for me, I probably wouldn't even be out of bed at this time of morning usually, but here we are. So excited to see you guys. If you want to turn in your Bibles to Acts chapter 20, that's where we'll be today. Acts chapter 20, I'm going to start reading verse 22. And now, behold, I am going to Jerusalem, constrained by the Spirit, not knowing what will happen to me there, except that the Holy Spirit testifies to me in every city that imprisonment and afflictions await me. But I do not account my life of any value, nor is precious to myself, if only I may finish my course and the ministry that I receive from the Lord Jesus to testify to the gospel of the grace of God. And now, behold, I know that none among you whom I have gone about proclaiming in the kingdom will see my face again. Therefore, I testify to you this day that I am innocent of the blood of all, for I do not shrink from declaring to you the whole counsel of God. Pay careful attention to yourselves and to all the flock, for which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers, to care for the church of God, which he obtained by his own blood. I know that after my departure, fierce wolves will come in among you, not sparing the flock, and from among your own selves will arise men speaking twisted things to draw them away from the disciples. This is the Lord's word.
My name is Ian, and I am one of the pastors here, if you have forgotten or if you're new here. What a joy it is to get to gather together, right? If you're like me, yes, yes. If you're like me, you have longed for this moment for months. And rightfully so, because we are the church. And that word in the Greek literally means gathering. We are called to gather here together to represent and to foreshadow a global gathering that is happening right now all around the world and will happen for all of eternity. Two things I want to say before we jump into the text about the current situation and this current longing we have to meet together. Number one is, remember this longing. Remember what it feels like to not be able to meet together as a church body. And then use that longing to propel us into action. Action that reveals itself in love for our church community, an action that reveals itself in love for those around the world who aren't able to meet because of persecution or circumstance, and then also action that reveals itself in love towards those people who don't have a church or are without Jesus and never get to gather together and be in fellowship with the people of God and God himself. And then number two, remember this longing and use this longing to propel us towards Jesus. I don't know if you feel the same way, but Reunion Sunday, as we had imagined it 3 or 4 months ago, was not to look like this, right? We were going to be together. Kevin's going to be running down the aisle, right? We got masks on. We're socially distant. We have sign-ups. Nobody hugged each other. That's the weirdest part. If you did try to hug somebody, you forgot. There was that awkward stutter. And in a sense, this Reunion Sunday is not as satisfying as I had envisioned. But church, the point is, nothing this side of eternity is perfect. And nothing outside of Jesus alone can satisfy the longing that we have. The moment for things to go back to normal, in a world where who knows what normal looks like anymore, pushes me towards my only Savior and my only comfort, Jesus. What I might have looked for in others, or in return to normalcy, or in Reunion Sunday, I now know that I can only ever find in Jesus. But today, we thank him for the privilege and the honor of getting to gather together and worship together today. Let me pray for us and we'll jump in to the text. Lord Jesus, we praise you. We give you all the praise for all the things you've done in these people's lives when we've been apart and not able to meet. But we're able to meet now, at least in some fashion, and we praise you for that. This is a gift. Lord, help us never to go back thinking that community is just not necessary. This is a gift. This is a privilege. This is something we need. Lord, be with us today as we look into your word. Lord, anoint me with your spirit to proclaim your words to your people. Your glory, here it is again here. I am so thankful to get to preach God's words to you. The text that we're going to walk through, Acts 20, you didn't read the whole thing, it's a long passage, is so rich. And it's one that also is so timely. And personally, for me, it's one that throughout my life has meant so much to me that I've often referred back to this passage. And this passage is, even what we did here, right, you can hear a weightiness in it, right? And this is because this is Paul's last words to the people that he spent so much time with. On the background is he's decided to leave the thriving church in Ephesus and in Macedonia and Achaia and then go instead to Jerusalem. Now Acts 19:21, just a few verses before, actually we see a shift of his ministry focus and a shift of his ministry plans, as it says, while he was in Ephesus. Now after these events, Paul resolved in the Spirit to pastor Macedonia and Achaia and to go to Jerusalem, saying, after I have been there, I must also see Rome. Now, in the missions training that I have led for the past 3 years since I've been a part of Calvary Wellspring, we talk about this being Paul's fourth missionary journey. And just so you don't know, they usually just talk about three missionary journeys that Paul made. But on this journey, he makes some far-reaching plans. His plans are he's going to go to Jerusalem, then on to Rome, and then we go from Rome, and he's going to go on to Spain and even to the ends of the earth. And on this fourth missionary journey, he has a bold strategy, a super bold ministry strategy. I mean, get this. His plan is he's going to go to Jerusalem, he's going to be arrested, and then while he's in chains, he's going to take his different Roman officers, and he's going to preach the gospel to them. And then he casts up all the way to Rome, where he will preach the gospel to the people in Rome, where he hasn't gone yet, and then even to Caesar, to preach the gospel to Caesar. What a bold strategy to get arrested so that you might be taken to the place where Jesus has not been named. In the 1700s, there was a group of people called the Moravians who were known for selling themselves into a lifelong of slavery so that they might be able to give the gospel to a group of slaves on an island where there was no witness. Now that is amazing, and that is inspiring, but the Moravians were not the first ones to craft such a bold ministry strategy. And in this last section of Acts that we're going to complete in the coming months, we will see how this bold strategy played out. Just like in that movie, God's Bold, where he says, bold strategy, Cotton, let's see if it pays off. But now, in our text, we see Paul calling together those from his previous missionary work and giving them one last goodbye sermon. He gives them his swan song, his final words of advice. As we saw last week, he goes down to Troas and he gathers the church together there, and he has so much to say. I mean, he crams so much into his sermon, preaches so late into the night, he's literally putting lives at risk. People are falling out of windows. I mean, Paul, get it together. And then, in our text, he goes from Troas to Miletus, as it says in verse 17, the first verse in our text. Now, from Miletus, he sent to Ephesus and called the elders of the church to come. And he sailed by Ephesus. He didn't want to go there because, not because he didn't care, but because he had a great affection for those people, and he didn't want to be taken off of this Holy Spirit emboldened strategy that he had to go to Jerusalem, to be in chains, to take the gospel all the way to Rome. And so he calls the elders, meaning the pastors and the overseers and the shepherds of the Ephesians church, and he gives his last words, what we're about to walk through. Now, last words are so important. They're often intended to represent a few major points that you are intending with your whole life, or with your whole example, or with your whole time with those people, they're intended to represent those points. And so we see everything that Paul is saying to the Ephesian church here is his heart, what he wants them to get, what he wanted them to get his whole life. And as such, he delivers them with one final thrust of force towards his hearers, obedience. Last words are important. There's an urgency that we see in them. Now, I felt the weight of this urgency in 2014. When I was leaving South Asia, my wife and I had lived there for 3 years. We had done missionary work there. And it started with a friend of mine who met one guy, shared the gospel with him, and he went back home to his village and started to build kind of a network of believers, and eventually they became pastors. These were a group of Muslim background pastors far away from us. And it led to what, by the end of our 3 years there, were supposedly, what they said, 30 churches and hundreds of believers. And just a few days before I left to return to America, we traveled out to that village, and we gathered together with them in sort of an upper room of sorts, and I delivered to them my swan song. And when I spoke to them, I looked at this very text, Acts 20. And in a small room, a very small room with no AC, and 110 degree heat, we walked through Acts 20 for about 3 hours. Now, nobody fell out of the window, but there was definitely some people nodding off during the sermon. But for me, it was an emotional event. I remember one time I had gotten so worked up. I mean, the thought that I might never see this group again weighed heavy upon my shoulders. And I would not be stopped or cut off until I gave them my peace. Now, the building that I was in was right next to some train tracks. And at one time, a train was passing by. And as the train passed by, I didn't want to stop talking. I was just into it. I needed to get this out. And as the volume of the train passing by rose, so did my voice. And then I realized at one point I was yelling at full tilt at these people. And then eventually my friend in ministry, he put his hand on my sweaty back and he said, "Brother, just wait. So we waited as the train passed, and then we went right back into it for hours. Last words are important. And so this text carries with it a weight. Because it's Paul's last words to one of his most beloved group of people he spent so much time with, 3 years in Ephesus. And even for me, this sermon holds a special weight because likely, even though I've learned that we don't know the future, this likely will be the last time that I get to speak to you before you guys send us back to salvation. And so I'm delighted once again to walk through this text with the people I love so dearly. I promise not to go for 3 hours or to scream at full voice. But we'll see. In Paul's final words to the church in Ephesus, he does what he's always done throughout his ministry. He appeals to his own example as a lesson for these very churches. He explicitly called people to look at his life many times throughout his ministry. Look at Philippians 3:17, I think it's on the screen here. He says to them, "Join together in following my example, brothers and sisters, and just as you have us as a model, keep your eyes on those who live as we live." Now today, what I want to do is look briefly at Paul's recap of his own example in the first part, and it's been the majority of our time talking about the explicit warnings and encouragements he gives to the elders there. First, Paul's example. As I said, I believe he sets the foundation one last time, explains his heart, and gives an example for the last advice he's going to give. From the very first words of his sermon, his swan song, he launches right into it in verse 18. "You yourselves know how I lived among you the whole time from the first day that I set foot in Asia." And then he recounts everything that he did while he was with them for the past 3 years. Now, we won't look at it in detail, but if you wanted to construct, you could reconstruct a Pauline missiology. Basically, what did Paul do as a missionary by all the things he says that he did while he was there? Just look at the verbs and what he describes. First, he says in 9 verse 19, "Serving the Lord with all humility and with all tears, with trials and having to do with God's afflictions." Even amidst all the hardships that he met in Ephesus, people speaking evil of him, and then evil spirits speaking well of him, copycats, plots and persecutions, bonfires, and citywide riots, he served the Lord faithfully. He persevered in the midst of these trials, and it was not easy. He said actually that it happened through many tears, but all the while, God was at work. As it said about his time when he was in Ephesus in verse 20 in chapter 19, So the word of the Lord continued to increase and prevail mightily. And this is because Paul wasn't caught up in the circumstance of all that was happening. No, he just faithfully served the Lord and preached that word of God. Whereas he details the rest of the things he did. Verse 20, how he did not shrink from declaring to you anything that was profitable. He says this later again, verse 27, for I did not shrink from declaring to you the whole counsel of God. And then back in verse 20, and teaching you in public and from house to house, and 21, testifying both to Jews and to Greeks in repentance towards God and our faith in our Lord Jesus Christ. And then he calls it, I had gone about proclaiming the kingdom, and then later, I did not cease night and day to admonish everyone with tears. Now get this, admonishing, declaring, teaching, testifying, proclaiming. This is the work of frontier missionary Paul. And this would be the work that he would encourage the elders to carry on. But as for Paul, as a frontier missionary, there was another thing that he had to do. Look at the next verb he describes his ministry. The next thing he says he is going. Verse 22, now behold, I am going. See, after he established a church network in that region, he goes on to region where Christ has not been named. Right? You might hear the unsaid words in this passage of the Ephesian elders saying, Paul, we were just getting going. I think we're just heating up. But just like the scope of Jesus' ministry, when he was in Capernaum, people came to him and said, this is great, there's crowds. And Jesus said to them, let us go on to the next towns that I may preach also there, for that is why I came. Paul goes onward and outward towards the ends of the earth, where there was no access to the gospel. And he does so by this bold strategy of going to Jerusalem and getting arrested. As he recounts here in verse 22, saying, constrained by this, and he goes there, constrained by the Spirit, not knowing what will happen to me there, except that the Holy Spirit testifies to me in every city that imprisonment and afflictions await me. And then Paul, in the final part of this first part of his example, he gives one last picture of his missionary mentality as an example to the Ephesians. He shows that he is singularly focused. This is one of the richest verses, I think, in the whole book of Acts. Acts 20, 24. He says, but I do not count with my life of any value, nor is precious to myself, but only I may finish my course in the ministry that I received from the Lord Jesus to testify to the gospel of the grace of God. Eyes on the prize, he doesn't consider his own life, his safety, his comfort, his hopes, his dreams as precious at all. The singular focus of his life was finishing the race to testify about the grace that Jesus had given him. What was precious to him was being used by Jesus. Now his heart was the same as the modern missionary who you might have heard of named Karen Watson. Now Karen Watson was a missionary who was martyred in Iraq in 2004. Now before leaving her church in California, she gave the pastors there a In Case I Die letter and left it with them. And they heard the news. And they found the letter. And they opened the letter. And then they find these words. Her post-mortem song. This is what she says. Dear pastors, you should only be opening this in the event of death. When God calls, there are no regrets. I try to share my heart with you as much as possible, my heart for the nations. I wasn't called to a place, I was called to Him. To obey, my objective. To suffer, expected. His glory, my reward. Don't both their words here just strengthen your resolve in following Jesus? I know it does for me. As I put together the sermon this week in my office, I just was brought to tears. And I was thinking, I am unworthy of this. So many times I hold my life as precious to myself. I am so weak. I am unlike Paul. I am unlike Maria. Because I'm unlike Karen. I need Jesus' strength to remove my hardest part, to remove the tendency to cling to my own life and my own comforts. I need the Holy Spirit. I need Paul's last words here. I need Karen's words. I want obedience to be my gift. And I want suffering to be expected. I want His glory to be my new reward. Luckily, Paul, with these last kind of words, that's the intended purpose, to strengthen the resolve of the Ephesians that he's leaving behind. Because in the very next verse, he transitions and says, in verse 25, now, behold, I know that none of you will see my face again. And louder, now, louder than a rushing train, he gives them some strongly worded charges where we'll spend the rest of our time. The first one he writes is in verses 28 and 29. He says, pay careful attention to yourselves and to the flock. Now this is literally the word beware. This is a signpost of what lay ahead for them. This is because he said, I know that after my departure, fierce wolves will come in among you, not sparing the flock. I mean, what language? Violent, hungry wolves are coming. He tells them, be ready. Pay attention to yourselves and to the flock. And he adds that they will not spare the flock, that they seek to devour the pastors and the sheep. Now, Paul, in a sense, sort of mentions two kinds of fierce wolves that are coming. The first one comes from outside the church. As he says, a fierce wolves will come in among you. Now, this first type of wolf coming from outside the church is commonly called by Christians persecution. And yet the church there was already aware of this one. This would immediately bring to their mind and to ours some persecutions and hardships that Paul experienced while he was in Ephesus. Riots and constant threats of violence. But you know what? Paul's predictions about what was to come was right. Not just in Ephesus, but in all the world. Persecution would come on the church. For 300 more years, the church would endure intense persecution from fierce wolves, such as Roman empires, the emperors, and the like. But the early Christians, they knew this. For them, truly, it was to suffer was expected. This was normal. And even today, this is not strange. Even the most conservative numbers on persecution around the world say that every month, 300 followers of Jesus are abducted, 200 are put in prison, and on average, 70 churches are attacked and 250 Christians are killed. Now, when we think about fierce wolves not sparing the flock, this is often the first thing that we think of. This is often the thing that we fear the most. In America, we are so quick to be unsettled when we feel the beginning of the winds of persecution. And likely, in America, this stuff is coming. It is due time that this season of abnormal safety in the West is coming to. We need the resolve like Paul is urging here. But we also need a different understanding as well about persecution. That's because when we focus on the prize and not ourselves, we realize that that first kind of wolf is much less dangerous than we might think. In fact, God uses it to spur on the expansion of the kingdom. This is what we see all throughout Acts, and this is what Paul saw. Just as Paul experienced in all of his journeys, the more this stuff happened, the more the word of God continued to increase and prevail mightily. And in reality, what can persecution do to us? If you believe in Jesus, you have been given the promise of eternal life. As Jesus himself said, do not fear those who kill the body, but cannot kill the soul. Jesus says the only thing they can do to you is just kill you. That's why the second century Christian, Justin Martyr, said boldly to the Roman Emperor in his time, you can kill us, but you cannot hurt us. And this is why Paul was summed up his ambitions here, saying, I do not consider my life of any value, but only that I might finish my course. What can it do to us? What can it do to the church of God? Paul is reminding the elders here that the church has been purchased, been obtained by the blood of Jesus, the Son of God. And now no one can snatch a single one out of his hand, and nothing can separate us from the love of God in Christ. So the wolf that comes from the outside, whether it is angry mobs with machetes, or whether it's supposed to be political policies or movements that we think are against us, whatever it is, real or imagined, cannot touch us. But the next one that Paul mentions, this is where the real danger is. And this is one that's much closer to home. See, the den of the first wolf persecution is far outside in the darkness outside the church, but this wolf's den is much closer, much scarier to reign. In fact, it's deep within our own wandering hearts. As Paul says in verse 30, and from among your own selves will rise men speaking twisted things to draw away the disciples. See, the warning here is that from within the church, from within that group, might come our own worst enemies, those who begin to speak and teach wrongly. The second wolf can commonly be called heresy, or wrong theology, or wrong thinking about God. People within the church will begin to preach and teach heresies, wrong things. Now, this is a grave warning for us. Now, when I say things like heresy or wrong theology, many of us will start to shake our heads and say, and immediately start thinking about somebody else, right? We think of that group. or that denomination, or that person I saw on TV, or that mega church pastor, or that person that disagreed with me on social media. But I want to encourage us to look a little deeper into the text and into our own hearts. He says that from within our own church will come people speaking twisted things. Twisted things. You see, it's not new things or completely different things, but things that have been twisted. See, all of our thoughts that are right and proper and good have just been twisted and turned. And so our focus, our gaze, has gone with them and rotated towards other things. Now, this is the plan of Satan. Remember Satan, the one who, it says elsewhere, prowls around like a roaring lion seeking someone to devour? Now, Satan wouldn't necessarily tempt a church like this to adopt an entirely different foreign theology, but he might tempt us to twist the ones that we hold so dear, to pervert the gold of those theologies. He might get us to exchange a focus on Jesus for a focus on ourselves. He might get us to make other things precious, other things more precious than Jesus, our lives, our safety, our entertainment. And Paul, in his current situation, makes this point saying, Jesus must be most precious to your soul, not your life, not your community, not your ministry. Is Jesus most precious to your soul today? Most precious. Not that he is just precious, but is he most precious? Does he occupy the number one spot? If not, our affections have become twisted. And when he does that, he's close to devouring thought. And so much in our life changes. And then he gets close to things like us exchanging faithful suffering for Jesus with acceptable levels of compromise. Or to twist the radical call of discipleship, one that says, anyone who does not bear his own cross cannot be my disciple, into an Americanized version of it that says, take easy, pursue comfort, pursue ease, don't risk too much, you don't want to be labeled as a radical. Or to twist our priorities, creating a new sort of American Christian religion, one that makes political party allegiance more important than our allegiance to Christ. Or to twist our mission, to make a church that was once on the offense by preaching the love of Christ retreat to defense, to preserve what's ours, put ourselves first, hold tightly to our supposed rights and risk nothing. Am I speaking too close to him? Forgive me. But Paul, in the next verse, in verse 31, speaks strongly as well. He says, be alert. This is literally the Greek, stay awake. Literally, be truly woke to your own sin and your own wandering hearts. Keep your eyes open. Don't let your gaze drift towards other things and therefore let them become more precious than they ought to be. Now, just as Paul warned them, this very thing happened in the Ephesian church after Paul departed. And we know this because of Jesus' own words spoken in a letter to them 50 years later. Now, flip briefly with me to Revelation 2. It'll also be on the screen. In a letter in Revelation 2, the church in Ephesus, this is what Jesus says. I know your works, your toil, your patient endurance, and how you cannot bear with those who are evil, but have tested those who call themselves apostles and are not, and found them to be false. I know you are enduring patiently, bearing up for my name's sake, and you have not grown weary. See, even perhaps at Paul's advice here, they were passionate about right doctrine. They were the loudest ones on social media, the most passionate when they saw something wrong. They had become pros at stamping out heresy and wrong theology, but even in this right pursuit, things got a little twisted because in verse 4, Jesus says this, but I have this against you. You've abandoned the love you have. They had abandoned their first love, Jesus. Their days had drifted from the sweetness of Jesus and over-rotated to looking at others or looking at themselves. And what was most precious to them at first became second, third, or worse. And how can our heart not break this? Church, don't let anything else take the number one spot of your affections. Following even good but slightly twisted things that pervert the emphasis on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, has devastating consequences for our life and our eternity, and this church, and me, to the ends of the earth. This is why Paul tells them in verse 32, and now I commend you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and to give you the inheritance among all those who are sanctified. In the first of Paul's two final encouragements, he commends them to God alone and then to the word of his grace. Now, this means, of course, the Word of God, meaning the Bible, but specifically the message that that Word portrays, the gospel of God's grace to us. Now, this is the news that Jesus, God Himself, looked on the state of the world, that we were lost and fallen and broken, like little children with a load of numbers, doing damage to ourselves and to others, and we're separated from Him. And He didn't opt for just sending down an instruction manual or a set of rules. No, He came Himself, taking on the flesh of man and accomplished victory with His life and His sacrificial death at the hands of His own creation. And He obtained us through His own blood. Not because of anything that we've done, but because of His grace. Now, this is the gospel. Church, just as Paul recommended to them in this season, let me be so bold to say the same to you. Church, we are in a unique season, are we not? Nothing seems normal. Everything is emotionally charged. Things around us might seem to be shrinking from the church. Calvary Wall Street, whatever season might be coming, let Jesus be your focus. Let Jesus be precious to your soul. You have been saved by grace. Fix your eyes on Him. What else do you need? The gospel alone, it says, is able to build us up and give us an inheritance of eternal life with Jesus in heaven. What else could we want? Persecution or not, what else could you want? Life? That's Jesus. Death? That's gain. Pandemic or not, what else could we want for? Reunited or apart, what is better than Jesus' love and grace? He purchased this church with the blood, with His very own blood. And so nothing can harm it. But threats from the outside, more like the twisted affections from within, to take our focus off of the main thing, and thereby do damage to our joy in Christ and inevitably to our mission for Him. See, when our gaze is not twisted by wrong theology, fixed on the grace of Jesus, the only thing that matters is that we're able to finish our course like Paul, to serve, testify, declare, admonish people with tears to know the joy of their precious Savior. To do whatever it takes, even to go to chains, to give away the grace that we've received. Now we see this last admonition of Paul, his final words to those he loved, that I believe sums up the aim of Paul's life that he refers to, and what he hopes for the elders of the church in Ephesus, and what I would leave with you guys today. God willing. Paul, seeing the danger that lies ahead, once again refers to his own example. Look at verses 33 and 34. He gives a quick, kind of weird example of him providing for himself while he is serving them. But then, in verse 35, he expands that example as an overall example for his whole life, saying, in verse 35, in all things, I have shown you that by working hard in this way, we must help the weak and remember the words of the Lord Jesus, how He Himself said, it is more blessed to give than to receive. He says, we must give. The last words of teaching he gives to the people he loves so much are what Jesus had taught him himself. That it's more blessed to give. He encourages you to be a giver, help the weak. Now, Paul was a giver. He gave his life first to Jesus, and then because of that, to the weak, to the Ephesians, and then to many more towards the ends of the earth. Church, are you a giver? Or are you a receiver? Is your Christianity about giving or a little more than just receiving? Now, following what Jesus says here, seeing giving as more blessed than receiving, changes everything about your life. It changes the aim of your work. It changes the aim of your hobbies. It changes your goals. It changes your ambitions. It changes what you might do with your summer, what you might use your vacation time for. A life that lives to give has its gaze and affection on Jesus. But a life that lives only to receive has its gaze twisted elsewhere towards ourselves. A life that lives as a receiver looks like caring more about ourselves than others. Or caring more about our family than other families. Caring more about our security and our financial situation than those that are less fortunate. Or caring more about our constitutional right to do something rather than protecting others from a needless sickness. Or caring more about our tribe than a tribe that is less fortunate. One that daily faces biases and even veiled threats of violence based on the color of your skin. And dare I say, caring more about those in the church who are stuffed to gills with grace rather than caring for those who are starving without Christ. Pursuing comfort and safety for our sake and none else. worry more of the enemies here in the church than the afflictions and the ailments outside in the world. Or in a sense, Lord, help me carry more about the church in this nation than about those who have no access at all to the gospel of grace that we have so freely received. Perhaps the orientation of our life in Jesus needs to change. Look at Jesus' life, the one who gave his life for you, and fix our eyes on him. When we take our eyes off Jesus, our first love, they always want it back to ourselves, and everything becomes about us and what we can receive. But when we fix our gaze lovingly on Jesus, who graciously saved us, then you get to see him in the lives of other people, and our life becomes about serving others and what we can do to give to them. And this is what makes you testify, teach, declare, proclaim, launch for 3 years in this hardship, sweat, and tears. Now Karen, that missionary who gave her life in 2004, finished her letter to her home church saying this: "The missionary heart cares more than something is wise, risks more than something is safe, dreams more than something is practical, expects more than something is possible, and maybe for sure after that, gives more than this." The book that this story is taken from is called Lives Given, Not Taken. See, when you live to give everything away that you receive, nothing can ever be taken from you. The worst thing you can do is kill you, persecute you, say any things about you, not with you. None of that is worth anything compared to the worth of knowing Jesus and the privilege of making him known. Karen's letter wraps up: "I was called not to comfort or to success, but to obedience. There is no joy outside of knowing Jesus is with me." So, Karen, are you a giver? When you live to give, instead of living to receive, everything changes. It's a joy now to help you. And because it's a joy, let's think. In the current events, what does it look like to be a giver? And who are the weak today that we must give to and care for? We have so freely received, why not freely give everything for those? Why not lay down our rights to protect the weak? Why not set aside party lines and speak out against injustices? And why not? Church, you've heard it enough for me, but let me shoot my shot one more time. Why not give your life to the cause of God's fame to the ends of the earth? Why not? What is your life? What is 40 years of your life? Is it too precious to yourself? Why not leave what is precious here, our comfort, security, family, friends, and a wonderful church life, for what is more precious, for the privilege of sharing the gospel with those who are perishing for lack of knowledge? See, as we close, Paul was a giver, and he was able to love and to serve the church in Ephesus. And the fruit of that love and that giving was that there was an otherworldly love relationship that formed between them. Look at the last verses. The one that brings me to tears when I think about our current situation, 36 to 38, when he had said these things, he knelt down and prayed with them all. And there was much weeping on the part of all. They embraced Paul and kissed him, being sorrowful most of all over the word he had spoken, that they would not see his face again. And they accompanied him to the ship. And even though there was such a sweet love and a precious relationship, because Paul was a giver, he could also leave the church in Ephesus, and he had to. Even though he loved the church there, a more powerful affection had power over him, and therefore he had to. He had to go down by the Spirit of Jesus to Rome. Nothing else mattered except giving away what he had freely received, where Christ had not been named. He had to. Where is what you have been so freely received and been blessed with? Where is it leading you? It led Paul to a vessel that would take him far away, to a ship, one that would sail onward towards imprisonment, hardships, ultimately beheading in Rome, but one that fulfilled his course in his ministry. Church, as Paul left with the others in Ephesus, let me leave here with you guys. Fix your gaze theologically and emotionally on Jesus. Let his grace be most precious to your soul, most precious. And then because we are called to him, let our course that Jesus sets before us be our utmost concern. And church, be yours. Lord Jesus, I thank you for your grace. Lord, I thank you that you've given grace as a means to redeem us, to make us come back into your fold and in your protection forever. You give us eternal life. Lord, help us to live in light of what we've received so freely and give it to others. This week, Lord, help us to give and give our life, give our time, give everything. All for your cause here in Aurora and to the end of the earth. just thank you for my time here with Wester. I thank you for the blessing that you've been to help me not to waste this blessing, and go to multiply to me here. Amen. As we have been doing every week, we're going to continue now to have communion. Now, we have chosen as a church, as elders here, not to do communion, not to do drive-by things or sit with you, because we thought, let's reserve that time for when we get back together. And we need this to signify and to remember Jesus' blood and his body that was shed for us in our own personal salvation, but also we do it together. We remember it together because we're united together in Christ and we are the church. And so, let's with joy get to take communion from Lord's Supper today. Here's what we'll do. We're going to just send one representative from your little pod to come up here and get it. We'll start on this side of the room, and they hold on to this side, and this side, and then this side. And then we'll have a benediction that comes up. Thank you.
he's a little rusty, sorry. And he's like, hey, you're supposed to be benediction, what are you doing? I was leaving, I don't know. So, thanks for coming. I know this is a little bit different than what we normally do, but I think you know this is the new norm. It reminds me, our passage today should have not been preached by anyone else but Ian. Thank you so much, Ian. That was incredibly powerful. It's a reminder to us that our life is not our own. And in the midst of all the chaos and all the craziness that's happening in our world right now, we should remind ourselves that God is still in control and he's still good. And he is our joy. And he is our affection. And he is what we look forward to. So if you'll pray with me, we'll be out of here. Father, thank you so much for this morning. God, thank you again that we can gather together for the last few months virtually. But it is a joy, really, to gather together in person, to share communion together. And Lord, we know that this is a small glimpse of what will really what we can be looking forward to, and that's to be with you. Lord, we pray that as we go out today, that we're mindful of the things that Ian preached, that we should be focused on the right things in us to make you know. Even as we go to the grocery store and social distance from people, as we go back to work, as we travel out on summer vacation, all these things, God, remembering that you are what we should be focused on, and you are the one that we should be making up. Give us those opportunities, give us that passion to be the glory user of Jesus. Amen. Thanks, everybody. Have a great week.